Good morning, Limitless Church. How y'all doing this morning? Are y'all ready to worship? Y'all ready to praise? Why don't y'all stand up as we open up in prayer, and we'll just invite the Holy Spirit in this place. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for this morning, God. We thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to bring you praise, to bring you worship. We just invite you in this place, Holy Spirit, Spirit of the living God, please come and have your way. We just yield to you, God. We just pray that you would move in the way that you want to move this morning, that you would speak in the way that you want to speak this morning, and we just thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Surrounded, praise is the
Spirit, realign your focus on the King this morning. This is not about religion, it's about relationship with the King of Kings. Lord, we just set our eyes on you, God. We set our hearts on you, our minds on you, God. We come, Lord, to commune with you this morning, Jesus. Sing a new song to the King. Come on and give him everything. Come on, sing a new song to him this morning. Open your mouths. Oh, we love you, Jesus. We declare you King. We declare you. Jesus, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God, we honor you, Jesus. We just rebuke religion in this place this morning, God. We just thank you for relationship with you this morning, Jesus. You are holy. Thank you. heart, say yes. Come on, can you just lift your hands and say, God, I say yes to you. Jesus, I say yes to you. Thank you.
Lord, come have your way in us. Oh, just allow the Lord just to touch you today. His presence is here. For about 2 weeks, God put a scripture in my heart, and I've just been meditating on it. And I know it was for me, but he wanted me to share it with you. And it's in Galatians 6:9. It says, so let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. And I know some of you today are discouraged and you're ready to give up. And it says here you're even tired. But God says in his word, do not give up. Do not get tired of doing what is good. And you might be in a season of where God wants you to forgive, where God wants you to love, where God wants you to be obedient, where you're in a season of being still and know that he is God, a season of trusting in him. And he says, if you continue to do what is good, you will reap a harvest of blessing. And any harvest of blessing from God is worth waiting for. Amen. And every good and perfect gift comes from him. And I just want to encourage you today just to continue to do what is good, what God has called you to do in this season, and do not give up and continue to reap the rewards that he has for you. Amen. And I just want to thank you for coming today. It's just been so awesome encountering the presence of God in this place. And we encourage you here at Limitless Church. We encourage you to encounter Jesus and live out God's limitless purpose through daily partnership with the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I just want to encourage you, even as we continue to worship a little bit more, I want you to lift your hands and I want you to say, God, I just want your goodness in my life. God, I just want to continue to do what is good. I don't want to give up on the things, the purpose you have for me. I want to be obedient in this season. And I just want you to surrender your heart today. And I just want you to say, God, I want your goodness. I want your love. God, I want to be obedient in this season. Let's just continue a little bit more in the presence of God.
Down on us. Would you rain down on us?
week, I just want you to remember the word good. God, I'm going to continue to do what is good. All right? And remember, every good and perfect thing comes from Him, comes from above. And I just want to welcome you to Limitless Church. Wasn't it awesome encountering the presence of God today together? And I just encourage you this week just to remember that scripture. It's Galatians 6, 9. God wants to give you a blessing and a harvest in your life. Just turn around, say hi to the person next to you, and the message will begin shortly. Welcome to Limitless Church. The vision of our church is to lead people to encounter Jesus and live out God's limitless purpose through daily partnership with the Holy Spirit. If this is your first time with us, we can't wait to meet you. Text the word Limitless VIP to 94,000 so that we can get to know you. You can even fill out a Connect card from the seat in front of you and return it to our VIP table on your way out for a free gift. Limitless Connect is your first step to joining and serving at Limitless Church, but it's about more than membership. It's about knowing God more, discipleship, and community. For more info, text Limitless Connect to 94,000. If you would like to take the next step in your faith journey and be baptized, you can sign up by texting the word baptism to 210-880-0950. Here at Limitless Church, we honor God by giving our first and our best through tithes and offering. There are several ways you can give. Text GIVE7 to 94,000 and click the link online at limitlesschurchsa.com. You can give in person by using the boxes on your way out or send by mail. You can follow us on social media at Limitless Church SATX. You may also subscribe to our YouTube channel at Limitless Church SA to catch up on our latest series and sermons. If you have little ones ages 5 to 12, we would love for them to join our Limitless Kids upstairs. We also provide a nursery for world changers 4 and under. We would also like to remind you to silence all cell phones. The message will begin shortly.
Come on, how many of y'all excited to be in God's house this morning? I don't know about y'all, but that doesn't sound like excitement to me. How many of y'all excited to be in God's house this morning? Well, I am so excited to be here. If you're new here, we just want to welcome you. This is your first time here. Thank you so much for being here with us. Church, can we give it up for our first time guests? Amen. Thank you so much again for being here. I always say this every time I preach. You could literally be anywhere in the world, but you're not. You're here. And so I believe that God has a plan for your life. I believe He's calling you today. I believe He's going to do something supernatural in your heart today. And I also want to just give ourselves a pat on the back for getting in church. Can we give ourselves a pat? You know, sometimes I feel like the enemy always tries to attack on Sundays, right? Like Sunday. You ever raise your hand? Can we be real? Like, we're good all week, and then Sunday morning happens. This morning, I woke up. I was good all week, and then I woke up with a migraine headache. And I was like, devil, I know you're mad for what God is about to do. And so I'm just thankful for the Lord. My name is Josh. I'm one of the pastors here at Limitless Church. The vision of this house, you'll hear us say this all the time, is to lead people to encounter Jesus and live out God's limitless purpose through daily partnership with the Holy Spirit. And so I love that about this house is our goal is just to lead you to Jesus. We want you to partner with the Holy Spirit. We want you to develop a relationship with the Holy Spirit that's not just on Sundays. I'm tired of seeing people be Sunday Christians, right? I want to see people serve the Lord every single day. And that's our goal, is for you to partner with the Holy Spirit. And as you do, I believe that God will do something great in your life. I believe He's going to reveal His purpose in your life. In fact, we are in a new series. How many are here for the past 2 weeks that Pastor Steve started this series? It's been great. It's called Limitless Purpose. And really what we're honing in on is God's purpose for our life. We want to encounter the Lord in such a way that He reveals what we're called to do. Because I believe when we figure out our calling, it's not just going to help us, it's going to help the people around us. Because that's what it's all about, church. It is all about people, and it's all about God's people and serving God's people. That's what the church is for. This is a hospital for the sick, for the lost. And so I'm thankful for the church. And so we're in this series where Pastor Steve, he's talking about four different guys that God put on his heart. The first week he talked about Moses, which I'm actually going to talk about again today, because after he spoke that first message, I couldn't stop reading about Moses, and I just want to give you more information on him. And then he talked about Joseph last week. Wasn't that awesome? Isn't our pastor awesome? Come on, let's give it up for our pastor. And he brought those two amazing sermons. And what I really believe is that there's a three-step process to finding our purpose. I really do. And if you want to write this down, you can. I'm going to get into the message, but I want to just let you know what this three-step process, what I believe. I believe that God has a promise for your life. If you're here today, I believe God has called you. Can you shout that out? I'm called. Say that. I am called. I believe you're called. God has a promise for your life. And God wants to get you all the way over here to the promise being fulfilled, which is your destiny. This is your purpose. This is the third step. But right in the middle, how many of y'all know we got to go sometimes through a process? Anybody in the process right now? And what God will do in this process is this is the moment of your life where He's developing you. This is in the process, I believe this is where you will hear from the Lord the most. I believe this is where you'll grow closer to the Lord the most. I believe this is where God is developing your character. And I want to say this, the process is not easy. It's not all rainbows and butterflies. Sometimes it's a difficult process. Pastor Steve talked about Joseph last week, and we saw a little bit of his process, how his brothers sold him into slavery and how he was accused of things he didn't do. And sometimes the process is difficult, and we might ask the Lord, God, why are you allowing me to go through this? And what he's doing, he's getting you ready for your purpose. Because sometimes when we get into the purpose too soon, how many of you know we're not ready for it? We're not ready for the platform that God sometimes puts us on. And sometimes we even can destroy the purpose that we have in Jesus if we get there too soon. And so this is what the process would do. I want to talk a little bit more about Moses' process today. I just want to share a little bit. I know Pastor Stephen, the first week he talked about Moses, he shared his story. I want to just share what Moses, how he grew up really quick, and then we're going to get right into this sermon. But if you're taking notes today, I want you to title this message, What's in Your Hand? Look at your neighbor, tell him, what's in your hand? Now look at your other neighbor that you didn't care about, and you picked the other one first. Tell him, what's in your hand? I want to just share a little bit about Moses really quick, how he was born, he grew up. He was born a Hebrew, and at the time, the Hebrews were under oppression of the Egyptians. How many of y'all know this story in Exodus? They were under oppression. The Bible says that the Egyptians were treating them so harshly. And the Bible says that Pharaoh noticed that the Hebrews were growing and they were having babies and their community was getting bigger and bigger. And so he had this thought in his mind and he said, oh my gosh, they're getting so big, they're going to overtake Egypt. And so what Pharaoh thought in his mind, he said, you know what, why don't we go and kill the babies? And he told the midwives that were taking care of the women that were having the babies, he said, if it's a boy, I want you to kill the baby. But the Bible says that the midwives weren't doing it. They were still letting the boys live. And so Pharaoh got so mad and he says, okay, you know what? We're going to do it ourselves. We're going to go into their homes and we're going to take the lives of these baby boys. We're going to get them and we're going to throw them into the Nile River. And as I was reading about this story, I'm like thinking, this is so crazy because this spirit is still running wild today. How many of y'all know that? That there are the enemy is still after our children. The enemy is still trying to kill babies in the womb, still murdering babies because you know why? He's scared of them because he knows what their purpose is. He knows that they have potential. And so this is why we need to pray for our babies. Amen. We need to pray for our children. And so the Bible says that Moses' mom, she's like, I ain't letting that happen to my baby. She wraps him up. She puts him in a basket. She sends him down the Nile River. And you would think like there would be crocodiles. The river was running wild. But I believe that God's hand was on Moses' life the way his hand is on your life. And so the Bible says that Moses shows up at the doorstep of Pharaoh's house, and his daughter, actually, she's in the Nile River taking a bath. She hears a baby crying. She picks up the baby. She feels bad for it, and she says, I want to take this baby in as my own. And so she calls his mom, and she says, will you nurse him? Then when he gets a little bit older, they send her back with Pharaoh's daughter. And so here Moses says he was born a Hebrew, but he was raised Egyptian. And so right away, we probably see that Moses had a little bit of identity crisis in his life. He didn't know who he was. I'm pretty sure he looked in the mirror and he saw all his Egyptian makeup and the jewelry, but he had that Hebrew nose or Hebrew skin color. And he's like, man, I just don't feel like this is what I'm supposed to be. And the Bible says all of a sudden he starts getting this passion inside of him. This was God's promise over his life. He started getting a burden. I want to tell you this, church. I want to say this. If you want to figure out your purpose, you want to figure out the burden that God has placed on your heart for people. You know, you see, I've talked to so many men and they're like, Josh, I don't know what it is. I just have a burden for people in prison. That could be a purpose that God is calling you to. Man, Josh, you know what? I feel like I have a burden to help those that are addicted to certain things in their life. I was addicted. I want to help. See, this is something that God is calling you to. And this is what was happening to Moses. The Bible says that he started to crave just to be with the Hebrew people. He was an Egyptian, raised as an Egyptian, but he wanted to be with the Hebrew people. And he goes down and he starts talking to them, wanting to be with them, because this is what God was calling him, putting inside of him. But he wasn't ready yet to fulfill the promise. So what happens is when he's there looking at the Hebrew people, the Bible says that there was an Egyptian and he was beating one of his Hebrew family members. He was beating him so badly that Moses gets angry. And the Bible says he looks to his right and he looks to his left. He doesn't see anybody. And then he goes and kills this Egyptian. And the Bible says he puts him in the sand, which probably wasn't the smartest idea to bury someone in the sand. And the Bible says that Pharaoh finds out. He tries to kill Moses. Now Moses is running for his life. He's in the wilderness for the next 40 years of his life. And that's where we find Moses. And Pastor Stephen talked about it the first week. Moses encounters Jesus in a burning bush, starts talking to Jesus. And this is what Jesus tells him. I want to read this to you. Exodus 3 verse 7 says this. Then the Lord told him, I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress because of their harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. I want to tell you this, church. Last night as I was reading this, my heart just went out for those that are crying out to God right now. If you're here today and you're in a season where you've been crying out, God, where are you at? I'm struggling internally. Maybe it's in your mind. Maybe it's in your heart. Maybe it's through sickness. And you've been praying. See, the Bible says that the Hebrews, the children of Israel, they were slaves for a very long time. And they could have given up crying out to God, but they didn't. And because they didn't, God heard their cry and they saw, and God saw them. And I want to tell you today, if you're in here and you're going through something, I want to tell you that God sees you and he hears you and he loves you. And I believe he's going to bring breakthrough today in Jesus' name. Amen. And then so it says, so this is God speaking. It says, so I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land. This is the promise. Remember that first step. It is a land flowing with milk and honey. And so I'm pretty sure Moses hears this from Jesus and he's excited. Because how many of y'all know the promise of God is exciting? You know, when God speaks to your life and tells you what you're about to do, you're like, yes, God, do it. Only you can do it. And you're all excited. But if you go down to verse 10, God's like, yes, I'm going to do it. But then he says this, now go, for I'm sending you to Pharaoh. You must lead my people, Israel, out of Egypt. It says, but Moses protested to God, who am I to appear before Pharaoh? Who am I to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt? And God answered, I want you to know this, because God is saying this to you. I will be with you. And this is your sign that I will be with you, who has sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God at this very mountain. So Moses is excited. I would be excited. This is a crazy task, a challenge for God, but he knows that God can do it. But God's like, I'm going to do it, but I'm going to do it through you. And I believe God is speaking this to his church today. He's saying, I'm going to do something so amazing in your life. I'm going to set the people around you. I'm going to set them free, but I'm going to use you to do it. How many of you have ever felt like you're just not qualified to do something like that? I know I have. You felt like you just weren't significant. You're like, God, who am I? God, if you only knew what I was going through right now, you probably wouldn't be calling me. But God knew everything about Moses, and he still called him. And so Moses goes back in this argument with God, and God is telling him, I'm going to use you. And Moses is like, no, God, I don't think I'm qualified. I'm not ready. I don't want to do this. And then finally they agree on something. And I want to go down to verse 19. And this is what it says. I love this. I want y'all to get excited about this verse, because I believe God is speaking to you this verse today. It says, but I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand forces him. Isn't that good? So what God is saying, he's saying, I'm going to set you, the children of Israel free. But the king of Egypt doesn't want to let them go. He has a grip on their life. He has a hold on their life. And it's only by someone stronger that I'm going to be able to do this today. And so maybe the enemy has a grip on your life today. And maybe he's had a hold on you. And God's saying, I know you feel like he's strong, but I'm much stronger. How many of y'all are thankful for the mighty hand of God in our life? And it says, so I will raise my hand and strike the Egyptians, performing all kinds of miracles among them. Then at last, he will let you go. And I love this so much. I love this so much because God is saying, I'm going to be so strong that he's going to have no other choice but to let him go. And I want to ask this question today. I want you to raise your hand. I was thinking about this. If you're here today because Pharaoh represents Satan, and Satan many times has a hold in our life. He has a grip in your life. Maybe it's through anxiety. Maybe you have anxiety in your life. Maybe you're struggling with depression, panic attacks. I know before I struggled with very severe panic attacks, like where it felt like my heart was going to burst out of my chest to the point where I felt like my heart would beat and I would worry. And I would go in my closet and I would curl up in a ball and I would tell the Lord, I want to die. I don't want to be alive anymore. I don't want to feel this feeling. And the enemy had a hold in my life. And maybe you're here and you're addicted to something, whatever it is. And the enemy's had this hold, and no matter how hard you've tried to break free from this, it just feels like the enemy will not let his grip go on your life. Whatever it is, marital issues, financial issues, if you're here today and the enemy has had a hold on your life, I want you to be brave. I want you to lift your hand. No looking around. This is between. I'm going to lift my hand with you, because this past week, the enemy attacked me very bad. Even in my health-wise, I don't want to cry, but I didn't even know if I was going to be able to get up here and preach this message. And I feel like the enemy didn't want me to, because the Lord was about to do something amazing through this message. And so I'm going to lift my hand. If you've had a hold in your life, this is why we're here, church. I want us to close our eyes. If you've had a hold, that the enemy's had a hold, a grip in your life, I want you to lift your hand right there. And we're going to pray right now. This is everybody. I think everybody has had a hold in their life. I want you just to say, God, free me today. Holy Spirit, I welcome you. Father God, I pray for your people, Lord. I pray the same way that you set your children free from Egypt, that you will set your people free today, Lord God. Whatever it is that they're battling, whatever grip the enemy has, I pray that your hand is stronger than the hand of the enemy, Lord God, that you will pry the grip of the enemy, take it away off of their life today, deliver them, set them free in the mighty name of Jesus. God, I declare there is no spirit but the Holy Spirit welcome in this church today. So fear, anxiety, worry, addiction, you must leave in Jesus' name. I thank you, God, that you are higher. You are greater. You are bigger than our problems. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everyone says, amen. Amen. Woo! I don't know about y'all, but I feel the Holy Spirit in this place. And so I feel this is what the enemy tries to do. He tries to get a grip on our life, and he doesn't want to let you go. Why? Because he's scared of you. The same way he was killing the babies because he was scared they were going to grow up and one day overtake him, the enemy is scared of your life. If you ever wondered, I just don't understand why the enemy keeps attacking my life. Anybody ever feel like that? Like, he just doesn't leave me alone. It's only because he's scared of you. It's only because he knows the potential that you have deep down inside. How many are thankful for God's call on our life? And so I really believe God's hand is, it's so much stronger. We need to realize the authority that we carry. And we need to realize that we have a Father who loves us. And he doesn't like seeing us bound. I was thinking about my boys. I have four children. Four children, three boys. There's so many I'm forgetting now. I have three boys and they are rowdy, church. Like I feel like I'm breaking up fights all day long. And it's just for no reason. Like my three-year-old Cash and my five-year-old Beckham, they're playing toys fine. And then Beckham decides to just grab one of Cash's toys and Cash looks at him and just boom, bops him up in the face. And then they're fist fighting and I'm breaking up the fight. And for some reason, Zion, our oldest, he'll try to get involved and he will grab Beckham and pick him up. And he's like, what, you think you're big? I'm big. And he's holding on to Beckham. And what Beckham does, he's like, Dad, help me. Why? Because he knows that my hand is stronger than Zion's hand. And so what I do, Dad comes and I pry the grip of Zion's hand off of Beckham's hand. And I say, what are you going to do, boy? You can't do nothing because I'm stronger than you. How many of y'all know that God is stronger than the devil in our life? And this is the lie of the enemy, that he'll come and say, you can't break free from this. You'll never be strong enough. You see, I'm pretty sure Moses, when he ran to the wilderness for 40 years, I'm pretty sure the enemy began to speak to his life, you're a murderer. God will never use you. You know that burden that you had in your heart? God can't use you because of what you did. But I believe that God's hand is so strong. And I've heard this saying in my life since I was younger. Have you ever felt someone, or maybe tell someone, does someone ever tell you God's hand is on your life? Anybody ever pray? Raise your hand. Anybody ever say, you know, I see God's hand on your life. I've been hearing this since I was younger. I was fortunate enough to grow up in the church. My grandfather was the founding pastor here at this church. It was once called House of Prayer. And he would bring in all type of evangelists and different prophetic voices into our services to come and preach. And many times I would go out for prayer and they would pray for me. And they would tell me this thing. They would say, Josh, the Lord's hand is on your life. I can see it. God's favor is on your life. God is going to use you in a mighty way. But as a young kid, I'm like, all right, cool. I don't know what that means, but it sounds cool. But it also sounds a little bit scary. Like, what does that mean? And over the years, I've seen God provide for me. Because how many of you know God's hand works in different ways? One way he can provide for you, he can give to you. It's so funny. I was thinking about a story. When me and my wife first got married, we were broke, like broke. There's a difference. There's like broke, and then there's broke. And we were broke. We had no money. We had $10 to our name. And I remember sitting right here in service, and the Lord told me, I want you to give that $10. And I was like, that's the devil for sure, because we need to eat after service. And we had planned to go to McDonald's and take the dollar menu, hopefully not spend the whole $10, right? Still have a little leftover for the week. And the Lord told me, give it. And I was like, you know what? I believe this is not the devil, because the devil wouldn't tell me to give. And I remember giving the $10. And once I gave it, I was like, crap, there's my money for the week. I probably shouldn't have done that. And I just said, Lord, I trust you. I trust that you are my provider. And I don't know if Dave remembers this, but David actually came to me after service and he said, Mijo, God spoke to me and he wanted me to give you this $100 check. And God multiplied what I gave 10 times and provided. Yes, thank God that God uses people like David. And I remember just seeing God's hand and providing, but I didn't realize that God's hand works in total different ways. See, I thought God's hand was only just giving. And then when he wasn't giving, I felt like he was mad at me. He rejected me. He didn't care about me. But how many know that the same hand that God uses to give, he also uses to withhold some things in our life? And I'm so thankful that God has withholded certain things. I'm so thankful today that God didn't answer some of my prayers back then. I'm so thankful that God didn't do the things that I wanted to do because it could have destroyed my life. And this is where I needed to see God's hand working in different ways that he would give, but he would also withhold. And with that same hand, I've learned that God also protects. See, his hand works. And I want you to get this because I believe many times, just like in the garden, when God was withholding something from Adam and Eve, the devil came and told them that God was keeping something from them and he didn't care about them. This is the same thing the devil would do to our lives, and it makes us want to sin and go against God. But we need to understand, no, God is protecting me from that thing because he loves me. He's a good father, and this is his hand at work. And even to the point where like I told you, I stepped into ministry too soon. I wasn't ready for it. I heard the promise of God on my life, and God told me, I've called you for my youth. And I got excited about this promise, and I went and told my grandma, and my grandma was like, start a youth ministry. And I was like excited, but I forgot to tell everybody that I was addicted to things, that I was struggling on the inside, that I needed healing from my heart. But I was just so excited about it. I said, all right, let's do it. So I jumped in this thing too early, and I ended up making some of the biggest mistakes in my marriage. And I still remember the day vividly, standing up there with the youth in front of me and having to tell them, guys, I made a mistake. I have to give this thing up. And I just still remember seeing the tears on their face like, are you kidding me? Like, this is all we got. And I just remember that failure that I felt. And then a week later, I was watching the video last night. I have it recorded. There was a pastor that stood right here and he prayed for me. And he was telling me, Josh, the Lord's hand is on your life. He loves you. He's with you. And he's going to be with you in the fire as you're going through this. And I remember thinking, the Lord's hand is not on my life. Like, if the Lord's hand was on my life, he wouldn't have let me go through this. But the Lord's hand was so much on my life that he took me out of that by his grace because he knew it was going to destroy everything if I didn't give it up. And so I remember this pastor telling me, he was saying it as God was speaking. He said, give me your Isaac. Give me your, and that ministry meant so much to me. He said, give me your Isaac. Give me your Isaac because I have something so much greater for you. And I remember just saying, okay, God, I'll give this to you. I trust you. Because I don't know if you remember in the Bible when God promised Abraham a son, then he gives him the son. And then all of a sudden God says, I want you to sacrifice that son now. And that son's name was Isaac. And so the Bible says that Abraham goes to the mountain. He's about to kill his son. But then all of a sudden, God stops him and says, Abraham, no, don't kill your son. Now I know that you trust me. And because you trust me, I'm going to multiply your blessings. And so I want to ask you today, what is your Isaac? What are you holding on to that you need to let go? What do you need to give God today? Maybe it is just the struggle in life that you need to give to God. And you need to begin to say, God, I lay this down at your feet. Because if we go further into the verses, we see God's hand, even God moving in a way where he puts pressure on Moses' life. This is another way that God will use his hand, is he will use a hand of pressure. He will use his hand to give. He will use his hand to protect. And he will put pressure. And I was even thinking of a story. I was telling Vanessa this before service. When I was younger, I was addicted to candy. And I still am, so pray for me. And Vanessa used to take care of me during service. Her and my grandma would switch off, and I remember I was sitting back there, and I remember I would always go through Vanessa's purse to look for candy. And she was like, Poppy, I don't have candy. And I was like, I know you do, and I was just scrounging through her purse, and I found a cough drop on the bottom of her. It was probably there for like 2 years, and like I didn't even know about it. But anything that had a wrapper and looked like a candy, I didn't mind. I was like, I want. And she was like, no, because you're going to choke. She was trying to withhold. She was trying to protect me. And so I was like, please, Vanessa, I want this. And she says, fine, well, let me bite it. And I said, no, I could do it myself. I want to do it myself. And she says, no, let me. And so I got it. I put it in my mouth. And right here, service was going on. My grandpa was preaching. And I'm smiling with all my silver teeth and cavities. And I'm so happy. And as I'm smiling, that cough drop goes down my throat and I start choking during service. during service, church. They should have probably banned me from this church at that moment in my life. And Vanessa starts screaming. Like, I can't imagine someone choking. I don't know what I would do up here. I would probably stop the service. But my grandpa kept preaching. He just kept going. Didn't even stop. And Vanessa's screaming. I remember my dad, he gets up, picks me up. My mom is screaming. They take me to the lobby back there. And my dad just starts slamming my back, just hitting. And the cough drops just comes out. And I'm just like all in shock. And I still remember what Vanessa said. I told you. This is why I was trying to keep this from you, because I knew it was dangerous. And how many of you know many times God keeps things from us because he knows it's dangerous in our life? But a lot of the times, what do? No, God, I need this thing. You know, we might be in a process where God has us in a season of loneliness, where he wants it just to be you and him. That's it. But you're like, God, I need friends around. I need someone here with me. And God's like, no, you don't. You need me. That's what you need. And what we do is we're like, no, God, I need this. And we go, and then it ends up destroying our life. And sometimes God will let us go through the pressures of life to build our faith. Because I've said it before, if God gave us everything that we wanted and needed, there would be no reason for faith in him. There would be no reason for hope. And he will put pressure on our life to relieve some things in our life. You ever gone to a place where they massage you and take out all the knots in your back? You ever hear of the place called Erosti? It's a place from hell, so don't go there. It is. I do not recommend Erosti. It helped me, but it hurt so bad. I haven't had a good back in a while. And so I had all these knots, and I went to this place, and they laid me on a bed, and they say, okay, Josh, we're going to put some pressure points. We're going to push on some areas. And I remember them doing, I was like, ah, like a squeal, like a girl. And they said, okay, that was 20%. I'm like, 20%? And so they push, and I'm screaming and holding off. And they said, the reason we're doing this is because this area in your back is confining you and constricting you. And it's so tight that you're not able to move. And I believe that sometimes God applies pressure in our life where we can't move. See, the children of Israel, they couldn't move anywhere. They were slaves. So what did God do? He said, my mighty hand is going to force them. I'm going to put some pressure on Pharaoh so that way they can be released from slavery. And many times God will put pressure on our lives. And so Moses here is battling. If you look in the Bible, this is probably the longest argument that anybody's ever had with God. Really, he's just going back and forth with God. God, I'm not good enough. God, I can't do this. I don't speak well. I stutter. And then God tells him this. And this is really what I want to focus on, because I believe that the problem here is, it's not that we don't doubt God's power and how strong he is. I believe that many people, you trust that God is strong and he's powerful, and you've seen him work in other people's lives. I don't believe that you doubt the hand of God. But I believe, you know whose hand you do doubt? Your own. This is the problem that we're having. This is why we're not seeing miracles happen in church. This is why we're not seeing revival, because too many of us are waiting on God when God is waiting for you to move. Somebody, God, we need to move. And God's like, okay, I'm sending you. But God, look at my past. God, look at what I'm going through. God, I'm struggling with this. And look at what God says. Exodus 4, verse 3. He's speaking to Moses. And I'm sorry, Exodus 4, verse 1. It says, but Moses protested again. What if they don't believe me or listen to me? And in fact, I kind of agree with Moses, if I can be honest. Because this is not an easy task that God has given him. This would be like God speaking to me and saying, Josh, what I want you to do, the United States, they're under slavery to sin. And so I'm going to set them free. And I get excited. And God says, but I'm going to use you to do it. And I'm like, okay, God, how? And he says, I want you to go to the president of the United States. And I want you to tell him to change things, because if he doesn't, then God is going to cause all these plagues. I would do the same thing. Like, there's no way. And then at the same time, imagine me seeing a burning bush with a voice talking out of it, and then going back to these people and saying, hey, guess what? God spoke to me that he's going to set you free. And they're like, how do you know? Well, there was this bush and it was on fire, but it wasn't burning up. And there was a voice. They would think I'm crazy. And so you would understand Moses like, Lord, they're not going to listen to me. He says, what if they don't believe me or listen to me? What if they say the Lord never appeared to you? And then the Lord asked him, I love this. What is in your hand? What is in your hand? I want you to look at your neighbor and tell him, what is in your hand? Moses says, a shepherd's staff. And I want to just talk a little bit about what the shepherd's staff meant for Moses. The only reason Moses was carrying a shepherd's staff in the first place is because he murdered someone in his past. He was carrying around this thing in his life because of what he did a long time ago. And I really believe that there's many of us, we've been stuck just like Moses in the wilderness for 40 years, not moving, holding on to something. And we've come to this place and we're here because of mistakes that we made in the past. Maybe your family fell apart. Maybe your marriage fell apart because of the mistakes. And now you're in a place where you're holding something that is dead, because that's what the staff was. It was something that was dead. It's just a stick. And this is you. You're like, God, this is all I have. This is my story. This is my testimony. I don't have anything else. This is all I got. I want to ask you this question today. What's in your hand? What's your story? What are you struggling with? What does your past look like? What has stopped you from saying yes to God? Because I want to say, whatever it is, God can use it. Whatever your past looks like, God can use it to help someone else. And you might be thinking, just like Moses, there's no way you can. I want to show you here. This is what it says. He says, what is in your hand? A shepherd's staff. Then we go to verse 3. It says, throw it to the ground, the Lord told him. So Moses threw down the staff. And I love this, because I believe that whatever's in our hand, if we surrender it and lay it at the feet of God, then that ordinary thing can turn to something extraordinary. See, this is why your story won't work by yourself. This is why you can't break free by yourself, because you haven't laid that thing down at the feet of Jesus. So I want to ask you again, what's in your hand? And are you laying it at the feet of God? God, this is what God tells him. Moses, what's in your hand? He says, a shepherd's staff. He says, okay, throw it down. We need to surrender what's in our hand to God. That's the first point. And it says, so Moses threw down the staff and it turned into a snake. And Moses jumped back. The Bible actually says, another translation says, he runs away. And I've heard pastors preach this and they say, the reason that Moses ran away is because God's glory was so strong. No, it wasn't that. It was because there was a snake in front of him and he was terrified. I don't know about y'all, but I hate snakes. I do. We had a picnic here for Easter and they brought in like a petting zoo, and these people brought in a big old python, and there was no way I was getting around that thing. And my kids, they were holding it and they were like, Dad, hold it. I was like, no way. I hate snakes. And so the Bible says that Moses throws the staff down, something that was dead. He threw it down at the feet of Jesus. And the moment he threw it down at the feet of Jesus, there was life that was brought. Isn't that good? So whatever you have in your hand, the moment you throw it down to God, God can breathe some life into your situation. If your marriage is dead today and you put it at the feet of God, he can bring life to your marriage. Yes, thank God for his hand. If you're addicted today and you lay it down at the feet of God, he can set you free in the name of Jesus. If you have a past that you've been holding on to that you just can't let go, and you throw it down at the feet of God, God can turn that past around. And I want you to see, God never forced Moses to throw it down. He didn't pry, like, Moses, throw it down. See, this is the thing. God's not going to force you to throw it down. It's going to have to be you walking in obedience and saying, okay, God, I'm willing to lay this down. So he throws it down. It turns into a snake. And I want you to see what God tells him to do. Then the Lord told him, reach out and grab its tail. Isn't that crazy? This doesn't even make sense. I don't know if any of you watched people mess with snakes, or those snake people, whispers, whatever they're called. You never see them going behind and grabbing a snake by its tail. I have seen videos of that, but that snake goes and bites them because the snake has the opportunity to turn around and bite them. I follow this guy on Instagram, and he just messes with snakes. And every time he grabs the snake, he grabs it by the throat so that way it won't bite him. And he's holding onto it and he's showing people in the video. So just the word that God gives him doesn't make sense. God ever give you a word and it doesn't make sense? See, this is where we have to trust in the word where it says, do not lean on your own understanding. And sometimes God gives us, and what God was doing was he was giving Moses an opportunity to trust in him. And many times God will give you a word that doesn't make sense. I want to ask you the question, are you willing to trust God even when it doesn't make sense? Even when it looks scary. See, what God was doing was he was making Moses face his fears. This is my second point. This is what God will do in your life. Because this is something that will paralyze us, is fear. You ever battle with fear in your mind? Like God's speaking for you to do something, you're like, I don't know. Yesterday I was at the barber and I was getting my hair cut. And I always talk to the barber about God, and I tell him about Jesus. And there was some other guy that came in, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me and told me, start making a conversation with him so you can talk to him about God. But what happened? Fear came over me. And I was like, no way, God. Like, what if this is weird? And he's like, bro, sit in the chair and shut up. Like, I was scared that this was going to happen. And I had this fear. And I started talking with this guy. And he started sharing back with me. And another guy comes in. And this guy's like, hey, bro, I've been looking for God. And I don't know. I've been torn between being a Muslim. And I've been torn between following Christianity. And I was able to share the gospel with this guy because I didn't let fear control my life. I said, fear, you're not going to control me. And this is what we need to do. We need to pick that snake back up and say, fear, you are not going to control me. But Moses had every reason to fear. Fear of failure. This is what he was telling God. What if I go and I tell them and they don't believe me? And I believe this is why a lot of people don't walk in their purpose, because they're scared to fail. God, I don't know if, what if I do it and I fail? See, that's not your job to determine if you fail or not. Your job is obedience, and the outcome is God's. The outcome is all for the Lord to say, hey, if this thing works or not, as long as you're obedient, that's what matters. And so Moses, he needed to confront the fear of failure. He needed to confront the fear of rejection. Maybe for some of you, you have the fear of rejection. You're scared of people rejecting you. That's why it's so hard for you to be close to people and give your heart, because you're scared that they're going to come back and just reject you because of the hurt in your past. Maybe someone has hurt you and they betrayed you, and now it's hard for you to open up and you don't trust anybody. I believe it's time that you face that fear in Jesus' name. Moses had to confront the fear of death. You think about it. Pharaoh wanted to kill him, and now he's going back to that place. He had to confront this fear of death. And this is the same thing. That snake could have bit him, but he had to trust God that God's word was going to be true and it wasn't going to bite him. The fourth thing he needed to do was he needed to confront the fear of just confronting his past. Because he never dealt with murdering that guy. And I believe that we just, sometimes we read in it and we're like, oh, that guy deserved it. No, this guy murdered someone and then he was on the run and he never dealt with what was in his past. And I believe a lot of people, they read the scripture that Paul says, let's do this one thing. I focus on forgetting the past and look forward to what lies ahead. And that is an amazing scripture. And what I believe it is in the context of is we don't let our past hold guilt or shame to us because God has forgiven us. But I do believe we need to deal with our past. I do believe we need to deal with the trauma that we felt when we're younger, because if you don't, it will deal with you in the future. See, I didn't deal with those things when I was younger. I didn't deal with all the hurt and rejection that I felt. So when I jumped into youth ministry, it dealt with me. And what God had to do, his hand, he took it away and he placed me in a season where he said, Josh, I just want you to focus on your healing. Because if you don't focus on your healing, you're not going to be able to help heal anybody else. It's like when you get on an airplane, what are the instructions that they give you? They say, hey, if this thing goes down, you focus on yourself. You put the mask on, you make sure you're good, you put your seatbelt on. Because if you pass out and you're trying to help someone else, you're not going to be able to help nobody. You're going to be passed out. And I feel many people, they try to help other people, and we can't help and fight when we're trying to heal at the same time. See, you can't fight and heal at the same time. You can't do all this stuff for the Lord and try to, see, God sometimes, this is what the process looks like. He wants to heal our past in Jesus' name. Amen. And the third thing we see that Moses needed to do is he didn't need to withhold anything from God. And I want to show you this in Exodus 4, verse 5. So this is what he does. He throws the staff down. Then he picks it back up. The Bible says, reach out, grab its tail. So Moses reached out and grabbed it, and it turned back into a shepherd's staff. Because every time our story's in our hand, it's ordinary. But when we lay it at the feet of God, it's extraordinary. But then God tells him to do this. In verse 5, he says, perform this sign, the Lord told him. Then they will believe that the Lord, the God of their ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has really appeared to you. Then the Lord said to Moses, now put your hand inside your cloak. So Moses put his hand inside his cloak, and when he took it out again, his hand was as white as snow with a severe skin disease. Another translation says he had leprosy. And this was what it's a skin disease that he had. So I want you to see this. So one moment, Moses
throws down the staff,
picks it back up, and he has it in this hand. And so God is like, what I'm doing, I'm dealing with what you did in the past. That's what the staff represents, what he did in the past. But then he said, Moses, now I want you to put your hand. And I could only imagine him putting his hand right by his heart. And he brings it out. And I believe what God was doing, he was showing him on the outside what was really going on the inside. And so he said, Moses, drop the staff, pick it up, one hand. He says, but I want to deal with the other hand too. Because I feel like many times we just show people the good hand. See, I want you to think about that other hand that no one knows about, just you and God. Y'all know what hand I'm talking about. Y'all know the anger that I'm talking about. Don't play me. Don't play me, church. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? Don't act like you're perfect. Every single person who has the other hand, you could raise your hand and say, I got that other hand that, man, I struggle. I'm going to raise my hand. Don't be ashamed, because every single person has that other hand that no one knows about, that you're really, really battling inside. So God was saying, I want to deal with what you did, but then I also want to deal with who you think you've become. Because if we know anything about leprosy, the Bible says that lepers, they must be in isolation. So for 40 years, this is where Moses was, in isolation, battling his past. He was believing a lie about himself. So God was saying, I want to heal what you did in the past, and I want to heal who you think you are. And God is telling you this today. He wants to heal what you did in the past, and he wants to set you free from the lies that you've been believing about yourself, who you think you are. I want you to think about that right now. What lies have you been believing about from the enemy that you think that's who you are? You're a failure. You're a terrible mom. You're a terrible father. And you've believed this. You've messed up your past. You've messed up. God will never change you. He will never heal you. And you've believed this lie. God wants to heal both hands. Look at what this says. It says, then the Lord said to Moses, now put your hand inside your cloak. So Moses put his hand inside his cloak. And when he took it out again, his hand was as white as snow with this severe skin disease. Now put your hand back into your cloak. And the Lord said, and so Moses put his hand back in. And when he took it out again, it was as healthy as the rest of his body. See, I believe this is what God wants to do in your life today. He wants to make you healthy. Because you can't fulfill God's purpose when you're not healthy. This is what God wants to bring to his church, to his people. It even reminds me of a story in Mark 3, verse 1, and I'm almost done. It says, another time Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. And some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus. So they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. And Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, stand up in front of everyone. And then Jesus asked him, which is lawful on the Sabbath? To do good or to do evil? To save life or to kill? But they remained silent, and he looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts. And he said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. And then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians that how they might kill Jesus. So I want you to see this. So the Pharisees were like, let's see if Jesus really heals this man on the Sabbath. Because if he does, we're going to come against him. And Jesus is like, hey, look at what you do on the Sabbath. If you have a sheep or something stuck in the pit, you're going to use your hand to care for that thing. But I can't use my hand to heal this person. And so this is the thing I love about Jesus. When it comes to leprosy, everyone else ran away from the lepers, but Jesus came close to the lepers. And so you might feel like if everybody knew what I was going through, if everybody knew what was inside, they would run away from me, but Jesus won't. See, the Bible says that even if your father and your mother leave, God will never leave you. See, people will leave you, people will fail you, but God always comes close to us. And I remember a time, and Kayla, you can come back up. I remember a time when I was telling y'all I had lost the youth ministry, and I remember a moment in time that I was just so ashamed. Every day, just thinking about what I did, who I hurt my wife, I hurt my family. I almost lost my family, and every day the enemy was just coming at my mind every single day. Josh, you're never going to be the same. God will never use you again. If people knew what you did, they'll never listen to your story. And he was trying to stop me as I was almost like a baby, hurting, crying, because he knew that one day I would stand up here and tell my story. And that story would help other people that were addicted, other people that were bound. And this is what God wants to do in your life. And I remember God speaking the same thing. Josh, just give me what's in your hand. And I was just holding on to it. But Lord, how can you forgive someone like me? How can you be there for someone like me? I messed up. I hurt my family. I did this and that. How could you do this for me? And he said, this is why I came. I came for those that are sick, for those that know that they need me, not those that think they have it all together. This is why Jesus came, for the lost, for the sick, to help those, but not so you can keep it to yourself, so you can help the people around you. And I want us to close our eyes, bow our head, and I want to ask you that question today. What's in your hand? What is it? Is it addiction? Is it fear? Is it just that past that has been haunting you for what you did? Maybe even the people around you, they haven't been able to let you let go of what you've done. There's someone in here today, you hurt your family, and you have so much regret. And now you're trying to make up for it, and you're trying to work hard. But the Lord said, hey, you don't have to work anymore. Just come to me. Just give me that thing. But if you're here today and you say, you know what, Josh, I have this other hand, that it's been a struggle. And again, if the enemy's had a hold on your life, whatever it is, I want you to lift your hand today. Come on, just like the man who had a shriveled hand, whatever it is, it's marriage failure, whatever it is, lift your hand, addiction. Just lift it to the Lord. I want you to keep it. So Jesus tells him to stretch your hand out. And as he stretches his hand out, there was healing that took place. So I want you to stretch your hand out right now in representation of God's healing over your life, that his mighty hand is about to break every chain in the name of Jesus. Every chain of your past that's been holding on to you, every bondage, every addiction, every anxiety, every worry, every depression right now, you must go in Jesus' name. You must leave their life. Come on, church, right now, just tell the devil, I renounce you, devil. You will no longer have a hold on my life. Come on, carry that authority inside of you. It doesn't matter where you are. God has placed authority in your heart. Say, devil, I renounce you today. I renounce you today. Pray for your family. If your spouse is addicted, if your spouse is hurting, just pray over them. Lord, I renounce you over my spouse today. You will no longer control them anymore, devil. You will no longer have this hold in their life anymore. God, we just lift it up to you right now. We stretch our hands. In representation, Jesus, in our faith, we trust in you that you're healing us today. And right now, as I pray, the Holy Spirit just spoke to me. As you lift your hand, what you're doing is you're releasing your past to him right now. In faith, right there where you're at, just release it. Everything you did, say, God, I release it to you right now. It's coming off of your life right now. I can see it in the spirit. It's coming off of your life. It's coming off of your life. It's coming off of your life in Jesus' name. It's falling off of you. The chains are breaking in Jesus' name. They're falling off. The enemy's hold is breaking. The Lord's mighty hand is stripping the enemy's hands off of your life right now in Jesus' name. Come on, if you have a heavenly language, we're not prophesying today, but just begin to speak in your heavenly language. Begin to pray for your neighbor right now. Begin to encourage them, whatever it is. If you know something in their life, if they need healing in their body, just pray for them right now. Jesus, we lift you up, God. We thank you for saving us, Jesus. There is no one like you. God, people might reject us, but thank you, Jesus, that you've never rejected us. Church, can we just stand to our feet? And if you need to come to this altar, and the enemy's had a hold on your life, we're going to pray over you that it's going to break, whatever it is. Right now, come on, can we just stay in reverence to the Lord? Let's close our eyes, bow our heads. Let's lift up the Lord today in worship. God, we worship you. I believe as you worship, his glory is going to fall. And wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. He's bringing freedom to your life today. He's breaking chains. He's breaking bondages. He's breaking trauma, even from molestation. Someone in this place was taken advantage of when they were younger, and the Lord is breaking that trauma off of your life right now in the name of Jesus. It will have a hold on you no longer in Jesus' name. God, we lift you up right now. We thank you, Jesus, for your presence. We just love you, Lord. Thank you, God. Come on, there's more people in here. If you have that other hand and you need God to heal you, let this be a moment. Don't leave here without a breakthrough. Don't leave here without God doing something in your life. Don't be scared. Don't be ashamed. Don't be like Moses fighting back with God. Say, God, I trust you. Pick that shepherd staff back up. Face that fear today, whatever it is. Jesus, we just love you.
That was awesome. That was awesome. And Josh is so right about what he said when he said, if you don't allow God to heal you, it is so important for him to allow God to heal you. I remember when we lost my dad in July, God began to speak to me in my life, and he began to tell me that I needed healing. And I could tell that it just kind of maybe like brought a season of like just being still and allowing God to heal me, and it was hard, and I wanted to do ministry and I wanted to serve, but God just says this is a season of healing. And right now in your life, this may be a season that just God just wants to bring healing in your life. And he's such an awesome Father, and he's such an awesome God that he cares, that he wants your heart to be healed. He wants your mind to be healed today. He wants his children to live in freedom, his children to live in victory. And like what Josh said in the message, that the enemy may have a hold on you and not let you go, even holding you on to your past and not allowing you to get victory. But one thing that I learned to allow the enemy to let go of me is just to begin to surrender your life and your heart to God and just say, God, touch me today. And as you begin to surrender it all to God, the enemy, the word says in James 4:7, humble yourself before God, resist the devil and he will flee from your life. And some of you, he has not fled from your life. He has had a hold on you, and you haven't been able to go forward in the plans God has for you. I heard this not too long ago, and it said that worship is warfare. And when you stop worshiping, you stop doing warfare. Don't stop doing warfare today. Don't stop worshiping God today. Amen. Just continue to surrender today during this time. God's presence is here today. He loves you so much. He loves you so much, just like we love our children. And even if you're young, your parents love you so much. God loves us even more, and He cares and He knows about every detail of your life. And He just wants to bring healing in your life. He just wants to bring purpose in your life. Oh, we just thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, God, just we thank you for your presence, Holy Spirit, that you're so good, God. Oh, you're so great. You're so great, Father. Oh, just continue to worship during this time. Oh, allow God to bring healing beginning today as we continue to encounter Him in His presence. Oh, we love you, God. Thank you for being such a good Father, for being so faithful, for loving us so much.
Hey church, I believe that there's breakthrough that God wants to do in this place. And I really heard that word in my spirit this past weekend was breakthrough. And I'm gonna invite Vanessa back up here in a moment, but that was such a phenomenal word. And I believe that the Holy Spirit is drawing people. He's wanting to bring inner healing, and He's wanting to bring breakthrough in your life. And there is a saying that many years ago, I heard a pastor say that there's two things that will determine your destiny, and it's the choices that you make and your response to God. So I believe that there's people in here that still need to respond. And really, I don't like to put pressure on people, but I really feel that there's breakthrough that needs to happen in people's lives. So I invite you, if that word spoke to you and you know God needs to break something off of your heart, I encourage you, come up to this altar and just pour it out to Him. And I believe that something supernatural is going to happen. So don't worry about what people are gonna think about you. We all need prayer. I need prayer. Pastor Josh said he needed prayer this week, and so do I. So can we just continue as we sing this last worship song? We're gonna go a little bit further into the presence of God. And if that's you, I want you to join us at this altar. Come on, there's people making their way up here. Just come and join us. And I believe that God is gonna bring breakthrough in your lives. So let's just worship. Worship team, come on. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you for what you're doing, God.
don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see that you're working, you never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Even when I don't see that you're working, even when I don't feel that you're working, you never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see that you're working, even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop.
Waymaker, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the dark.
Such a good God. No, we serve an awesome, mighty God. Like Stephen said, that was an awesome message, and I believe it was planted on good ground. Amen. I'm going to go over some announcements right now. Limitless Connect is now live. If you haven't gone to Limitless to do your connect with God, text connect to 210-880-0950. David's Tabernacle of San Antonio will be here Wednesday at 7 a.m. Come and worship God, hear a good word from Kayla, and just encounter the Lord like never before. The next baptism Sunday will be July 21st. Sign up by texting baptism to 210-880-0950. Also, if you want to give at limitlesschurchsa.com/give, or text give 7 to 94,000, or you can also give in a person in the boxes in the back. But I'm going to go ahead and pray. Holy Spirit, we just thank you that we were able to encounter you today, God. I just thank you that the word you gave today, God, was planted on good ground, God. I thank you for the encouragement today, God. The freedom you're going to do even today and this week, God. The healing and the health that is going to come out of your word today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.